Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Win an Argument, an Ancient Guide to the Art of Persuasion, by Marcus Tullius Cicero, translated by James M. May, read by Simon Vance. Preface. For as long as human beings have had the ability to communicate, we've endeavoured to persuade one another, whether it be for the purposes of mere survival, or to control the circumstances of our lives, or to bring someone around to our way of thinking, or merely to win an argument. We have relied on some form of persuasion, either physical force or what we would consider more civilized means, speaking and writing, to accomplish our goals and purposes. The art of verbal persuasion, in a word, rhetoric, was discovered in the West in the democracies of Syracuse and Athens during the 5th century BC. Citizens in democratic societies were expected to express themselves in assembly, represent themselves in courts of law, and participate in other civic functions. As a result, in order to enable people to operate successfully in society, attempts were made to describe effective means of verbal persuasion, and a theoretical system evolved that enabled citizens to plan and execute a successful speech in public. In other words, to win an argument. Several centuries later, Rome's greatest orator, and one of the greatest speakers of all time, Marcus Tullius Cicero, secured Rome's highest political office, the consulship, having relied heavily on this art of verbal persuasion to make a name for himself in Roman society. Trained from boyhood in the technicalities of rhetoric, Cicero excelled not only as an effective public speaker who won the vast majority of arguments in which he was involved, but also as a theorist in the art of verbal persuasion, having written during his lifetime several treatises that have rhetoric as their subject. And although he is highly critical of the typical rhetorical handbooks of the day, he was nonetheless steeped in their doctrine and reliant upon their methods. In fact, this rhetorical education for civic duty, handed down by the Greeks and adopted by the Romans, remained a primary element in the training of all educated people throughout the Middle Ages into the Renaissance and even down into modern times. Given the centrality of rhetoric, that is, the art of verbal persuasion, in our Western tradition, I present here a short anthology of passages from Cicero's writings, primarily his rhetorical treatises, that capture the essence of this ancient rhetorical system of persuasion, a system that helped to make Cicero and countless other orators effective speakers, able to convince people and win arguments. Listeners will, I hope, find these selections interesting in their own right, as well as useful when thinking about their own efforts to persuade. Indeed, whether arguing with a friend over a trivial issue or presenting a brief before the Supreme Court, the goal of a speaker is still to persuade, and knowing the most effective means of persuasion in any given circumstance will lead to the successful realization of that goal. A peculiar paradox of contemporary American society is that, at a time when we find many schools, colleges, and universities talking seriously about fostering oral competency and good communication skills in their students, we actually see very few effective public speakers in action in the courts, in our communities, or in the public arena of political life. While this book is certainly not intended to remedy that situation, my hope is that those who think about speaking in public and want to win arguments will find it appealing and will delight in the realization that the techniques for effective oral persuasion discovered and enunciated millennia ago still make sense and have great relevance for those who would speak convincingly today. In order to simplify matters and allow for smoother listening, I have avoided appending footnotes to names and terms that might present challenges to listeners who are unfamiliar with the historical period or the technical subject matter. James M. May, St. Olaf College. Cicero's Life, a Brief Sketch. Marcus Tullius Cicero was born on the 3rd of January, 106 BC, in Arpinum, a town approximately 70 miles southeast of Rome, to a family that, though not members of the Roman nobility, was prominent in the local community and had important connections in the capital. While Marcus and his brother Quintus were still boys, the family moved to Rome, a move aimed at advancing the education and prospects of the brothers. There the boys were brought into contact with the two leading orators of the day, Lucius Licinius Crassus and Marcus Antonius, who were later to become the two chief speakers in Cicero's greatest rhetorical treatise, a dialogue on the ideal orator, De Oratore. In such an environment, from boyhood on, Cicero was able to observe Rome's leading speakers and statesmen operating on a daily basis in the courts and in the forum. After Crassus's death in 91 BC, Cicero, at the age of 15 or 16, assumed the toga of manhood and was formally introduced to Quintus Mucius Scaevola, the augur, one of Rome's greatest legal experts, who was also given a place as one of the speakers in De Oratore. Under his tutelage, Cicero acquired his enormous respect and knowledge of the civil war. The young Cicero was no doubt a precocious student. In addition to his oratorical and legal studies with Crassus, Antonius, and Scaevola, he developed an interest in and abiding love for philosophy. While still a teenager, he published his first rhetorical work, De Inventione, or On Invention, which in later years he would describe as the sketchy and unsophisticated work that found its way out of my notebooks when I was a boy, or rather a youth, De Oratore 1-5, though even that work continued to exert a tremendous influence on rhetorical and oratorical studies throughout the Middle Ages into the Renaissance. After a brief tour of military service during the war with the Italian allies, Cicero returned to Rome that, during the decade of the 80s BC, was largely torn apart by civil strife, bloodshed, and proscription, brought on by the conflict between the strong arms Marius, Cinna, and Sulla. When some sense of order had finally been restored and the courts began to function again regularly, Cicero took up his first civil cases, to be followed in 80 BC by his first criminal case, his defence of Roscius of Ameria, on a charge of parricide. Shortly after this impressive victory, he decided to continue his education by spending about 2 years on what amounted to a grand tour of Greece, where he met, interacted, and studied with several prestigious rhetoricians, orators, and philosophers. He returned to Rome in 77 BC, a more vigorous and refined speaker. Cicero was now nearly 30 years old, the minimum age requirement for standing for the office of quaestor, a sort of public treasurer or paymaster. As mentioned earlier, his family was not numbered among the Roman nobility. None of them before him had become a Roman senator by virtue of being elected to public office. Thus, as a so-called new man, novus homo, Cicero found himself in a notably disadvantaged political position, seeing that election to the higher magistracies at Rome was jealously guarded by and generally restricted to members of this nobility of rank. Nonetheless, he managed to win the election, finishing first on the ballot and in his first eligible year, and served as quaestor in Sicily. The connections he forged there accrued to his benefit 5 years later, when the Sicilians, recalling his good and upright service, enlisted him to prosecute Gaius Verres, the corrupt governor of the island from 73 to 70 BC, on a charge of extortion. His stunning success in the case against the power of the senatorial order and Hortensius, the most famous advocate of the day who was defending Verres, catapulted Cicero into the limelight as Rome's leading orator and advocate. Other political offices followed for Cicero: aedile, praetor, and finally consul, the highest magistracy in Republican Rome. During the final months of Cicero's year as consul in 63 BC, he uncovered a plot to overthrow the government, led by a revolutionary, bankrupt senator of noble descent, Lucius Sergius Catilina. Through his diligence, the assistance of informants, and his inspiring oratory, students of Latin will be familiar with the justly famous Catilinarian orations, Cicero managed to thwart the coup and, with the threat still imminent, to gain approval of the Senate over the objections of some for execution of the conspirators without a trial. In the aftermath, a public thanksgiving was decreed, and Cicero was hailed as Pater Patriae, Father of the Fatherland. In this moment of triumph, when he had seemingly managed to unite the Roman people against the threat of the coup, Cicero envisioned a harmony among the various social classes of Rome, Concordia Ordinum. Only a few years later, however, forces would conspire to dash that dream and to transform the source of Cicero's crowning glory into one of debilitating disgrace. In 60 BC, various manoeuvrings and political machinations had fostered an alliance between three powerful men, Julius Caesar, the great general Pompey, and the wealthy Marcus Crassus, a distant relative of Cicero's boyhood mentor. Although initially invited to join the coalition, Cicero ultimately could not bring himself to support this so-called first triumvirate, and they in turn were content to give free rein to his opponents, chief of whom was his arch-enemy, the tribune Publius Claudius, who managed to force him into exile in 58 BC for executing Roman citizens without a trial. Taking refuge in Greece, Cicero endured the most miserable year and a half of his life, during which he suffered acute depression and even contemplated suicide. The Senate recalled him in triumph in 57 BC, but the triumvirs still held sway in Rome, and had warned Cicero, through the agency of his brother Quintus, not to pursue any policy hostile to their interests. In fact, at the behest of the triumvirs, he was even forced against his will to defend several of his former enemies. In this sort of repressive environment, Cicero turned to writing, and spent the last several years of the decade composing some of his most important and significant literary treatises, including De Oratore, on the ideal orator, De Republica, on the Republic, and De Legibus, on the laws. In 51 BC, Cicero was assigned by the Senate to serve as proconsul of the province of Cilicia, in Asia Minor, modern southwestern Turkey, where he executed his duties honourably, restoring order and even undertaking a brief but very successful military campaign against some warring hill tribes. The political situation back in Rome had been deteriorating for several years. The triumvir Crassus had been killed on military campaign in Parthia in 53, and the relationship between the remaining triumvirs, Caesar and Pompey, was fast approaching a breaking point. Only a few weeks following Cicero's return to Rome from his governorship in Cilicia, full-scale civil war broke out, January 49 BC. After much hesitation, personal deliberation, and a failed attempt to reconcile Caesar and Pompey, Cicero eventually joined the Republican forces under the command of Pompey in Greece. But following their defeat at Pharsalus in 48, he returned to Italy, and after another stretch of agonizing uncertainty, was among those pardoned by Caesar and permitted to remain in the country. Others in the Republican cause, including Cato the Younger, fought on. During the ensuing dictatorship of Caesar, Cicero again saw his opportunities for playing a significant role in the public arena greatly curtailed. Moreover, the tragic death of his beloved daughter Tullia in 45 BC forced him further into withdrawal and near despair. As he had done a decade earlier in forced retirement, he turned to writing as he searched for consolation, and during this period composed a remarkable number of rhetorical and philosophical works, including Brutus Orator De Finibus Bonorum et Malorum on Moral Ends, Tusculan Disputations, and De Natura Deorum on the Nature of the Gods. While not directly involved in the assassination of Julius Caesar on the Ides, 15th of March, 44 BC, Cicero viewed it as an opportunity for the Republic to rise again from its ashes. But the subsequent actions of Mark Antony, one of Caesar's close friends and his colleague in the consulship that year, soon led Cicero to fear that Rome had merely substituted one tyrant for another. Taking up what would be his final and perhaps most courageous cause, he managed to rally the people and the Senate of Rome through a series of speeches that he called Philippics, likening them by their title to the speeches that the great Greek orator Demosthenes had delivered 300 years earlier against Philip II of Macedon. But in the end, Cicero's hopes of a restored republic were dashed when the young and ambitious grand-nephew and heir of Caesar, Octavian, later to be Caesar Augustus, joined forces with Antony and Marcus Aemilius Lepidus in a second triumvirate that immediately set about eliminating their opposition to control of the state. Cicero's name appeared prominently on the list of the proscribed, and after being hunted down near Formiae, his head and hands were severed from his body by Antony's minions and brought back to Rome, where they were prominently displayed on the rostra, the speaker's platform where Cicero had so often stood to address the Roman people. Cicero's enduring legacy stems largely from his writings. In fact, we know more about Cicero than perhaps any other person of antiquity, largely owing to the vast corpus of his works that survive today. Nearly 60 of his speeches are extant, as well as a score of philosophical and rhetorical works and almost 1,000 personal letters. These writings have been valued from his day down to our own times and provide for us the portrait of the man in all of his dimensions: orator, rhetorician, politician, philosopher, and patriot. How to Win an Argument. The Origins of Eloquent and Persuasive Speech. Nature, Art, Practice. The precise nature of eloquent and persuasive speech was fiercely debated in antiquity. Is rhetoric an actual art or merely a skill, a knack? Does it require natural ability, or can it be mastered merely through the acquisition of certain techniques and the memorization of a body of rules and precepts? Generally, the ancient theorists spoke of a requisite triad, natural ability or inborn talent, mastery of the art of speaking as outlined in rhetorical treatises, called artes in Latin, and diligent application of one's talent and training through practice. In his earliest published work, De Inventione, or On Invention, written when he was about 17 years old, Cicero offers an explanation of the origin of eloquence. And if we wish to consider the origin of this thing that is called eloquence, whether it be an art or a study or some sort of skill or a faculty bestowed by nature, we will discover that it was born from most honourable causes and continued its development for the best of reasons. For there was a time when people wandered in the fields far and wide, like beasts, and preserved their existence relying on uncultivated food. No rational system of religion or of societal obligation was yet practised. No one had witnessed legitimate marriage, nor had anyone looked upon children whom he knew for certain to be his own, nor had they realised what advantages an equitable code of law might provide. So, because of their own error and ignorance, a blind and reckless passion controlled them, and in order to satisfy itself, continually misused bodily strength, the most dangerous of servants. At this point in time, a man, great and wise to be sure, came to recognize the innate potential and the boundless opportunity for great accomplishments residing in the human spirit, if only someone could draw it out and improve it through instruction. He systematically assembled the people in one place. Scattered in the fields and living hidden in their woodland shelters, he brought them together, introducing them to every useful and honourable pursuit. At first, because of the novelty of the thing, they strongly objected. But then, as they began to listen more earnestly, he transformed them through reason and speech from wild, savage creatures into tame and gentle people. To me, at least, it does not seem possible that mute wisdom devoid of speaking ability was suddenly able to turn people from their accustomed ways and lead them to different modes of living. What is more, once cities had been established, how could it have happened that people learned to honour faith and uphold justice and became accustomed to obeying others willingly and judged that they must not only take on great tasks for the sake of the common good, but even sacrifice their lives? Unless others had been able to persuade them by eloquence of those things that they had discovered by reason. Certainly, no one who was endowed with great physical strength would have willingly and without violence submitted himself to the law, allowing himself to be put on an equal footing with those over whom he could excel, abandoning voluntarily a most agreeable custom, especially a custom that had through the course of time already acquired the force of a law of nature. Had he not been moved by speech both powerful and persuasive. Eloquence, then, seems initially to have originated in this way, and to have advanced to greater development, and likewise, subsequently, in the most important matters of peace and war, to have been involved with the highest interests of humankind. De Inventione 1:2-3. Some 30 years later, Cicero wrote De Oratore, on the ideal orator, a masterful treatise in which he constructs a portrait of his ideal speaker. The work is composed as a dialogue between several of the leading orators of the generation previous to Cicero's. The two main characters of the dialogue are Lucius Crassus and Marcus Antonius, Cicero's boyhood mentors and the greatest orators of Rome at that time. In the following passage, the interlocutor Crassus refers to these same origins of eloquence. He extols the capacity for speech as one of the most powerful and efficacious of all human gifts, and encourages his young protégés to master the art of eloquence. Actually, I think nothing is more admirable than being able, through speech, to take hold of human minds, to win over their inclinations, to drive them at will in one direction and to draw them at will from another. It is this ability more than anything else that has ever flourished, ever reigned supreme in every free nation, and especially in quiet and peaceful communities. What could be so wonderful as when out of an infinite crowd one human being emerges who, alone or with very few others, is able to use with effect the faculty that is a natural gift to all? Or what is so pleasing to the mind and to the ear as speech distinguished and refined by wise thoughts and impressive words? Or what so powerful and so splendid as one man's speech transforming the impulses of the people, the scruples of jurors, or the authority of the Senate? Again, what is so regal, so generous, so magnanimous as lending aid to those in distress, raising up the afflicted, offering people safety, freeing them from dangers, saving them from exile? At the same time, what is so vital as always having the weapons available with which you can shield yourself and challenge the wicked or take revenge when attacked? But really, let us not always be preoccupied with the forum, with the court benches, the rostra, and the senate house. If we consider our leisure time, what can be more pleasant or more properly human than to be able to engage in elegant conversation and show oneself a stranger to no subject? For the one thing that most especially sets us above animals is that we converse with one another and that we can express our thoughts through speech. Who, then, would not rightly admire this ability and would not think that he should take the greatest pains in order to surpass other human beings in the very thing that especially makes humans themselves superior to beasts? But let us now turn to what is surely the most important point of all. What other force could have gathered the scattered members of the human race into one place, or could have led them away from a savage existence in the wilderness to this truly human, communal way of life, or, once communities had been founded, could have established laws, judicial procedures, and civic rights? And to avoid enumerating still more points, they are actually almost numberless, let me summarize everything in a few words. I assert that the leadership and wisdom of the perfect orator provide the chief basis not only for his own dignity, but also for the safety of countless individuals and of the state at large. Therefore, young men, continue your present efforts and devote all your energies to the pursuit you are following so that you can bring honor to yourselves, service to your friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.